And joining us on Hot Copy this morning, one of the cabinet members of President-elect Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., we have incoming Department of Agrarian Reform, Secretary Conrado Estrella. Secretary Estrella, good morning to you, sir.
Good morning to you, Idol.
Thank you very much for joining me on the show. You have a lot of work on your hands, especially with the fact that the president's aspirations starts with 20 pesos per kilo for rice. But let's start first with, when you take office, what will be your priority in the first 3 months?
In the first 3 months, I have to do a lot of house cleaning. I have to do a lot of putting the house in order. Like, for example, I would like to check if there is a, if there is in their possession a data which gives me the correct figures. Like, for example, who among the recipients of their, of this program are still the owners of these lands? Because I gathered, and you too, I think you gathered that too, that there are some who have already sold or have assigned, reassigned the ownership or assignment of their lands. Mm-hmm. And also, of course, I would like to see if there is an updated amortization table. That is very important, because that is where we will determine whether we have to still condone it or still pursue a collection, because it's very difficult. I also heard that there's accurate information that there is no such thing as an updated amortization table. Yeah. And then, of course, it's high time that we should start maybe seriously in the partialization program of this, because they issued a collective CLOA, Certificate of Land Ownership Award. No? Mm-hmm. And let me just touch history for a while, if you will allow me, Karen. Because during the time of my grandfather, was the first Secretary of Agrarian Reform. The coverage is only rice and corn.
Okay.
So it was simpler. And what was issued then was the certificate of land transfer, which was very definite. No? Kapag halimbawa, inisyu ang kanyan, yung pangalan talaga, iisa lang pangalan ng nandoon. No? When the administration of President Cory Aquino took over, they changed it into CLOA, from CLT to CLOA, and then they issued collective CLOAs. I have no objection with that. And of course, the coverage, it became comprehensive. Hindi pa nga tapos yung rice and corn, in-include na lahat. So sa akin, okay lang yun. Ano? But then again, the problem lies where they issued collective CLOAs. There are so many names there. And then, like for example, for a 1,000 hectare land, no, there are 300 beneficiaries all listed in the collective CLOA.
Yeah. Which is actually one of the issues right now facing Hacienda Tunting, right? But let's discuss that. Let's talk about that later. So that's one. That's one issue.
Yeah. They did not pinpoint where these beneficiaries will stay, or which land, which parcel of the land are they going to occupy? Ikaw ba, Juan de la Cruz, doon ka ba sa malapit sa irrigation? Ikaw ba, doon ka malapit sa boundary? Walang ganun eh. There was no, ano, but,
okay.
Well, there are some places also that I was told that the beneficiaries agreed, were able to agree, but that is a success story of the Department of Agrarian Reform. But in some places, walang nag-agree, Department of Away and Reklamo yan.
Well, Department of Away and Reklamo ang nangyari. Okay, let me correct myself. I meant that was the same situation as Hacienda Tinang. But first, you are batting for the condonation, right, of the arrears of the farmer beneficiaries. Yun muna. Condonation would mean you have many farmers who are supposed to amortize, right, but they're not paying. So what has happened to that? Is it possible just to condone the arrears?
May I interrupt you for a while?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I did not say that I am batting for condonation. For the record, what I'm saying is that we should study whether the cost of updating this amortization table might even be bigger, the admin cost, economic cost, even including the political cost. Yeah. Might be even bigger than the benefit. Uh-oh. If that is so, I might as well condone it. But if not, if there are other remedies where we could afford to update the amortization table, then there's no problem. We will do it. We will update. But if not, and we find out that it is costlier to go through this procedure in order to put things in order, we might as well just condone it and then issue titles. Now, in the time of my grandfather, from CLT, once you have completed your amortization fees, they issue an emancipation patent. I don't know what we will call it here. It might be a title, just a simple title. Okay. And it would be nice if we could issue them the titles. Those agrarian reform communities that are already doable, where we could already issue the titles in the event of complete amortization fees, completed amortization fees, or maybe in the future condonation, then we could already issue titles.
Okay, quickly. Yeah. Secretary, let me move on to several topics now. So what can you do, for example, with the farmers who were given their land in 1995? This was the 200-hectare disputed land. Ito yung Hacienda Tinang. And I'm sure we're all aware of what happened last June 9, wherein we have 90 farmers, land reform advocates, students, journalists. They were arrested. And of course, the Commission on Human Rights is investigating that issue. But the bigger issue is the fact that it was already given to them in 1995, and yet they're still waiting for their official installation because the decision was never enforced. What can you do about that? At ba't ganun katagal?
When you say it is given to them, I think we will have to define that. You see, the process is first it is assigned to you through the CLOA. And once you are able to complete the amortization, that is the time when it is given to them by a title. Okay. A title, no?
Pero bakit ganito katagal, Secretary? I mean, if it's assigned to a farmer in 1995, it is now 2022.
I agree with you.
How long should it take?
You know, there are many places. There are many agrarian reform communities that have succeeded also. No? Those that were, whose names were placed in the CLOA, they are now the ones personally using the land. No? But I agree with you. I wonder, that is one thing that I'd like to find out, get to the bottom of it, why there are some beneficiaries whose names already are in the collective CLOA, but do you know that up to now they have not yet? They were not able to enter the stands assigned to them.
Yeah. So what's the problem, Secretary? This could be a major challenge that you could change. In all these years, was the DAR inefficient? Has it been a forgotten agency? Have we forgotten our farmers? You know, to the point that you have assigned land that was meant to be theirs, that was meant to be tilled and owned, and yet for so many years, they're fighting for the ownership of land that's meant to be theirs. That's one. Has the DAR become that kind of agency?
I don't want to comment on that.
Okay.
I'm sorry, but I cannot do that to the former and the incumbent.
Yeah.
Yeah, but let me just say that I guess what I have gathered is that the reason for these beneficiaries not being able to occupy their lands, and I was told, and I will really verify, that there are no roads leading to these lands. Okay. That's why infrastructure is needed. And glad to know that we still have, I was told that we still have funds for farm to market roads, and that is one immediate concern that we should address.
Will Hacienda Tinang be a priority for you?
Of course, yes. Okay. In order to, you know, if you prolong this, it might lead to violence that we may not be able to control. We just have, there are existing laws that will address these matters. We just have to follow existing laws. And I was, Congressman Noel Villanueva called me up regarding this matter, and I said, pasensya ka na pare, hindi pa ako pwedeng gumalaw dyan kasi hindi pa ako ang incumbent. Mag-assume pa lang ako. So, babayaan natin yung incumbent na gumalaw muna in the meantime. And then, pagpasok natin, we'll get to the bottom of it. Ganun lang yan.
Okay.
May I just finish, Madam Karen? You know, in some places, I was told that some of the beneficiaries were not able to enter the lands assigned to them. No? Kasi may konting pressure from the original landowner. Merong konting, you know, all those sorts of things, may harassment, ganun. And that is one thing that I'd like to look into also. And as much as possible, we could prevent incidents like Hacienda Tina.
How will you prevent agricultural land from being transformed into subdivisions? We have seen so many developers transform agricultural lands into subdivisions. What will be the policy of this government?
You mean carpable? Carpable lands that were transformed into subdivisions? Mm-hmm. Well, if it is not productive, why not? But if it is productive, I think that has to be, we should not, we should study this carefully because, you know.
How do you balance that? Because of course, there's also a need for industrialization, such as also renewable energy, housing, but then we also have to grow agriculture, the sector of agriculture.
Considering the fact, Karen, that our population is growing, but our agricultural lands are shrinking, that's I can foresee that as a problem. The saving grace is that there is new technology where smaller lands can be as productive or even produce surplus. Take the model of Taiwan. Only 35% of their land is arable, but they are able to maximize. They have surplus.
Yeah. Yeah.
They are able to export. Same with Israel and with other countries. I think we should adapt their technology. So when you are talking about conversion, that has to be studied. You know, there should be a team up with the Department of Agriculture and Department of Agrarian Reform.
Agree.
Because if the Department of Agriculture will say that yes, we can let go of that. Anyway, wala naman, hindi naman napaka-acidic ng soil. Eh, you have to conduct also a soil testing.
But I think, Secretary, the challenge for you is you do have an incoming president with a 31 million vote mandate, very popular, and somebody who wants to make an impact in his leadership. You must feel the pressure. Clearly, you have to be quick. You have to be fast. You have to act fast. That's the difference with the new appointees.
But yes, I agree with you. Yeah. We have to be quick. We have to be fast, but not enough. But not fast enough to commit mistakes.
Yeah,
it has to be there in all things in life. There should always be a balance, you know.
All right. Okay. Another question, quickly, lang sir, is the DAR suggested that the 20 pesos per kilo can be achieved if instead of subsistence farming, we move to commercial farming. And Secretary Cruz, the present DAR secretary, wanted to pilot test 150,000 hectares of land. And he claims that with the right support, right mechanization, irrigation, etc., it could produce 23 million kavans of rice. Secretary Dar of the DA says he doesn't know how that math is possible, considering that right now with more than 150,000 hectares, 4.5 million hectares were producing less. So I wanted to ask you, was that proposal even possible?
Well, it's not my habit to be discrediting other people.
Yeah. But can you do that? When you take over, is that something you can do?
I myself, Karen, spend my days also in the field. I'm a farmer. And I had a dialogue with some farmers. Sabi ko sa kanila, halika kayo, let's do some pencil pushing, sabi ko. Ito ba, posible ba ito na mapalabas natin ang farm gate price natin is at least 10 pesos? Kinumpute namin yung cost sa tractor, sa ganito, sa ganyan, etc. Fertilizer, and all inputs. No? Hindi kaya eh. Hindi talaga kaya. Ang posible 14. Which means kung farm gate price ay 14, no? Pagdating doon sa miller,
28. At
pagkatapos doon sa retailers, pwede tayo sa 28, safe tayo.
28. Yeah.
And maganda 'yan, that's possible because alam mo ba na ang byproduct ng rice millers, yung tinatawag na DRAC, no? Yung D1 na DRAC. From 9 pesos, 19 pesos na ngayon yan. Ginagamit yan na part hinahalo sa feeds para sa ating livestock, no?
And so, what you're saying, it's not possible?
I don't think it is.
Yeah.
In the very near future, Karen, it's not possible. But you know how technology is, di ba? In technology, the only thing permanent is change. All of a sudden, we are given by the Lord a miracle for a new technology.
All right, my question. Secretary, did you want to be DAR Secretary or DA Secretary? Were you given a choice by President-elect Marcos? I'm just curious, behind the scenes, were you offered both posts and you chose one, or did you want one or the other?
That was the hint, actually, whether... And I chose Department of Agrarian Reform. And for the obvious reason.
So in a way, he did make you choose DA or DAR. Is that correct?
Yes, I chose DAR.
What made you choose DAR, considering, offhand, the DA's budget is far bigger than DAR, right? That's number one. And the DA is perceived to, of course, hold more responsibilities in terms of the sector compared to DAR?
Well, because of historical considerations, of course, primarily.
Yeah.
As you know, my grandfather was the first agrarian reform secretary. Yeah. Yeah. And it's a great challenge for me to be the last, because we would like to be issuing titles under the term of His Excellency yeah. President Bongbong Marcos.
That's why this is a legacy you want. The title yes. be handed out during this term.
Yes.
Yeah.
Actually.
Uh-oh. Okay.
Yeah. You know, when you said earlier, with the pressure in our shoulders, no, that 31 million voters voted for the president, the new president. That's not only the pressure that both of us have. You see, he told me when he appointed me as Agrarian Reform Secretary, he said, alam mo, Conrad, yung susundan natin, yung tatay ko at yung lolo, parehong magaling yan. So pumantay lang tayo, pwede na. Sabi niya.
Sabi niya. Oh, okay. All right.
Now, natin.
Now, before we close, I know you have an 8:30 meeting. Is I'd have to say that in 2015, you were one of the hundreds of lawmakers who were linked with a Napoles pork barrel fund scam. You said the NBI said that your signatures were forged in those documents. So you and your brother were actually included in the list. So two questions for you, sir. How do you prevent, now that you're DAR secretary, how do you prevent another Napoles from coming into the picture in the whole agrarian sector? And number two, essentially, can you update us what's happened with your particular case?
I'm glad, Karen, that you mentioned that we really have to clear our names. First of all, in the case of my brother and myself, in the commission on audit, we were already exonerated because not only our signatures being forged. By the way, I filed the case against those who witnessed against us. And they lost in that case. And the court nullified all documents pertaining to our case. So and not only that, the barangay officials, even Napoles herself, and even Benher issued affidavits clearing us. And also in the ombudsman, I was told that it is already dismissed. But even if it is not yet dismissed, it could already qualify more than enough for an inordinate delay. I wonder how we will be investigated if documents pertaining to this case have been nullified by the court. So I'm glad that you raised this so we could clear our name, because we were persecuted at that time. Bakit daw kami lumipat? Because we supported the Senate President Manny Villar then, because Manny Villar was NP. My grandfather was Mr. Nacionalista in Pangasinan. When my grandfather decided, we have to toe the line. And yan, nagalit sila sa amin. Bakit daw?
So what you're saying is you were linked because of political reasons.
What else?
Okay. All right. Now, moving forward, because you are the incoming DAR secretary, how does the industry prevent another Napoles from coming into the picture or something like that? Because at the end of the day, diba, it's the agricultural sector that suffers. It's the farmers who suffer. It's the sector itself who suffers. There's money, but it never seems to go where it should go. What would you do?
Well, very simple. First of all, you have to be transparent, of course. And it has to be, the program has to be participatory. And then I think it's high time that we bring government closer to the people. You will not, do not expect an agrarian reform secretary who will be an armchair executive. No
so
way.
You'll be on the ground. You'll be traveling all the time. This is how you're going to be.
That has always been my trademark, Karen. I've always brought government closer to the people. And that's probably why the president chose me also, because it's the same. In his case, he wants to bring government closer to the people too.
All right. Well, on that note, congratulations to you, sir. And I wish you luck. And I do hope that you make great changes in the next 6 years. And I hope you come back to the show when you're already sitting in the dar. Thank you, sir.
I'm back to your show. Are you kidding? Even if you do not invite me, I will go. Let me just
thank you.
Little time that my three sons who graduated from San Agustin, they always hear you speak during Foundation Day. And they
send
them, they admire you so much.
Thank you. All right. We'll see you again and congratulations to you. I wish you well, sir.
Thank you and God bless.